So I would like to invite the main two speakers. The floor is open for discussion now. We've got time till 11:45, okay? We've decided to prolong the discussion and then, of course, a wee coffee break.
Yes, of course, I'd like to thank all three speakers for the very sort of lively and beautiful way you presented those papers. It's because there were narratives, it's strange the way they work so well together in different ways, but I have two questions, lots of questions, but I'll introduce them to two. The bearers are such wonderful stories, and the examples are great. And there's a Christian narrative, so large narratives there. You do face a little bit, though, the Christian sort of influence there, whereas you're not going to be coinciding, it's going to be a Christian narrative that's going to radically and aggressively, from Charlemagne's own words, destroy the bearers, and this is going to be an imposition of new narratives, and it's an attack, it's a war against the bearers. It's going to be killing 7,000 bearers per year. That's going to change the territory where the bearers are associated with the front. So the in and out moving into those narratives, I suppose, is that's going to affect that. So my question there is, to what extent does the Christian narrative superimpose? And the question for you, thank you very much for that, which is so stimulating. You're doing the what and the how, you're not doing the why. The why would be the market. So how does the why question, how would you, say what is being translated in why? My problem would be something like Boris Johnson, who I know why. He's writing on Churchill and saying, yes, I'm a bit like Churchill. I don't know why the whole of Europe is translating it in Brexit, English, ideology. It's the market. The market's taken over. We're no longer then one culture, but in this European recuperation of a marketable product, which is going to disseminate us for whole European, anti-European things. So the why for hearing this sort of Christian narrative that's hostile to and eradicating this animism.
When I was studying Christianity, I was trying to make a very simple point, which is the notion of the hierarchy of beings, right? Which is what we use to interpret the tales, and many times that's what we use to interpret the tales. You're right that Christianity did eliminate a lot of bears, right? Charlemagne, for example. With that, though, what you have happening over time is the fact that this belief was really ingrained, and there have been studies done. There's a lot of research in this area showing what happened when this belief in a ursine divinity, because it goes much more, what I covered was a tiny, tiny part of the research, that you had a belief in a god that was bear-like, and then at the same time that we were bear-like. So there was an identity there. And that was suppressed, the Christian folks really wanted to suppress it. But if I could just take a moment to give you an example of how it did not work. They realized at some point that the belief was just too strong. And people were not going to give up, just like the straw bears that have continued to run around Poland. They could not get rid of it. And so what they came up with was a different system. And it was a way to absorb it and somehow obtain dominance. So what they did is the following. The bears were being taken around, real bears, right, were being taken around to do healing ceremonies. The bears took part in what are called good luck visits, where they would go around to homes with the bear, the trainer, musicians, other characters from the bear son's story. And these visits were to bring good health and well-being. In Bulgaria, the house visits continued to go on until the First World War, where the Bear and Trina were called upon when someone fell ill. They went to the house and they made house calls. Right? This was also happened in other parts of Europe. So, how did the church deal with this? The church came up with the idea that we will tell stories, and these stories are all over Europe. If you start digging into stories about saints, you find that the saint or a bishop or an archbishop is going through the woods, he's, you know, proselytizing, bringing Christianity, the good word to all of the people, and he has a donkey. Sometimes it's a burro, right? And the burro is helping him carrying his stuff. And overnight, a bear comes and eats the burro. Right, so the saint is stuck where the bishop is stuck with no one to help him. Right, so he turns to the bear, and he says, "You found the wrong thing. You ate my burro, that's not right. You know, that's not right. Really, I'm bringing the word, and this is a very important mission, etc., etc. And you need to help me." And in all these stories, the bear goes, "Okay." he's immediately submissive. You know, he's a wild beast. He's been trained, you know, tamed by the bishop or whoever. And then off goes the bishop with his bear. Right. So now you have reproduced what was there before, but you have Christianized it, and the bear is supposedly submissive. Now, to give you an idea of how close this is to, you know the story of Saint Nicholas. But a lot of people don't realize, if you go to Germany, you go to Bavaria, and St. Nicholas shows up with who? The bear. Right? He's still there. In the case of the United States, when they were reinterpreting the figure of St. Nicholas, right, from Holland, he came and he had a little black figure, and those of you who know something about Black Peter realize that figure eventually got eliminated. The little black servant was the bear from before, right? So when, as time passed, toward the end of the 19th century, the tradition of bringing gifts at Christmas time was taking over. There was a commercialization of what had been a really kind of wild carnival during the Christmas period from December 5th on. And there was a poem that was written. And all of you, of course, probably know the poem. It has something to do with the night before Christmas. And there was a little book that came out that was for children. On the cover of the book was a picture of the gift bringer. And the cover of the book was done by an illustrator who had grown up in Bavaria, but had gone to the United States. So the first cover that was published shows the gift bringer in a little brown suit, very furry, with paws, right? Which is actually a replication of what are called the Pelzniggles, who are the little bears that go with St. Nicholas in the south of Germany. When they redid the book, it was re-edited, they changed the cover and they recolored it so that the little bear now turns out to be a person, right, in a little suit that is red and white with fur. And this is how we end up with Santa Claus. It didn't work.
Yes, thank you very much for your very interesting papers. And I...
I lost the thread. What was your question, James?
You did the what and the how, but what about the why? The why, the market, the money, the why are we translating this for it? Is a why that question? How did you experience that question?
Why? No, this at least is very simple. Because Davis is a Polonophile, Phil Polonophile, he loves us, and that's why we love him, naturally. He has a second wife, and the first wife was Polish too. He speaks Polish, and he writes in the British tradition of people like Gibbon and Taylor. In other words, his historical narrative is a good read. And that's why people love him in Poland, even though my own experience for the last 20 years has been constant combat with the editors, and it started with a story about the abduction of Europe, where summing up the story, David says, so this was a tit for tit. And there is a Polish equivalent, a nice one, but the Polish people in the audience would probably agree that tit for tit would not be possible, even though it's lovely. So this was my first concession. And since then, if you ask me why afterwards, just to quarrel with the editors. Because they said to me, no, you can't say that, it's not in the dictionary. And I would say, how do you think dictionaries develop? So that's what.
Okay, Professor Karnowska.
Yes, I just wanted to ask or to make a comment of Professor Rosnett Frank about, you know, when you, this was quite new to me when you talk about this kind of bears, especially in the Basque context, but it made me think of the wolf. And I wonder if you try to draw some comparison with wolves. Of course, you know, there are these well-known stories about werewolves. But 5 years ago, I remember there was a very interesting animated movie made by a Japanese director. I can't remember, The Wolf Children. I don't know if anybody knows. And it's exactly the same pattern. And I'm not sure if this comes from Japanese folklore. As far as I know, wolves in Japan are extinct now. But the idea is that there is the wolf, and who has children with a woman, and then his children actually go back to the wolves. And this way is this kind of, the race of wolves is reborn. So I'm just wondering if this wouldn't be kind of interesting to see how these similar patterns are also using different cultures and the different animals. And also, when you talk about the ogre, for example, these transformations, isn't it like from Puss in Boots?
It's like pardon?
Puss in Boots.
Oh, Puss in Boots.
Yeah, because there is this the challenge, right? The ogre, or the Puss in Boots challenging the ogre. And then the ogre turning into a mouse and getting into a mouse and Puss in Boots devouring it. And this goes back, I'm not sure, to Perrault. And as to Professor Tabakowska, I must say that in a number of cases I would agree with your editor. So here, because, you know, for example, with those very colloquial modern phrases like Spanelski, Niogarniać, I would be afraid to use such phrases, because when we think about aging of translation, we know that these colloquial, very modern slangy expressions actually age faster than more kind of neutral or expressions that are more deeply rooted. And I can't imagine Norman Davies also speaking in Polish that he would use these expressions like Nieogarniać or Szpanerski. And also in terms of syntax, you gave this very interesting example of this first sentence where there was this byłem, byłem, was, and you would, from what I understood, you would insist on using the past tense. You know, that's what bothers me a lot in translations from English, when translators actually use the past tense because they literally render English syntax, because in Polish syntax there is lots of flexibility, while in English you have the sequence of tenses where you have to stick to the past voice. voice. So in my opinion, for any narrative or historical narrative, it's much more clear or natural if you mix the tenses. And for example, these very slangy expressions, I would use them in a maybe in a modern novel, but not in a not because I am sort of very puristic or whatever, but just for me it would create some kind of clash. But it just shows, it was a comment, it shows kind of probably, you know, that it's very individual, the sense of what is right or what reads well. So probably if I were your editor, you would quarrel a lot.
I'm trying to cover it. What you were talking about is a very complex issue. In Japan, wolves are extremely important. They do play a big role in kind of the mythology and of the culture. But you also have, that's the Japanese component of, but you also have the Ainu. And the Ainu, of course, have their bear fest, and they have the bear god, and they have the bear ancestor, and all the rest of it. As for the werewolf, I think what you got there again is shape-shifting, you know, this old belief, you know, that somehow animals and people can go back and forth. I don't know whether there's a direct line from what I was talking about to the werewolf. That's maybe, but it would take a long time for me to try and explain why the maybe is there, which I won't do at this point. So you were saying how wolves and bears fit together. There's a fairly general old European belief that during the winter the bears are asleep, right? They're hibernating. And that's when the wolves rule. And so you have an association, a certain degree of association, like kind of dividing the year up into two parts. The year in which the bear is active, the bear wakes up in the spring, lets all of the souls of all the plants and animals loose, right, because the bears kept them inside. This is a Pyrenean belief. And then, of course, nature begins, and it's the renewal. Then, by the time you get to the fall, the wolves start to take over. The bear disappears. The wolves then end up being associated with shortage, with, you know, lack of food, with the hard period of winter. So that is, you get kind of a dualism that comes from the opposition of bears and wolves.
Right. I begin with a simple thing, the tenses. Tenses work differently in Polish than they do in English, which is a platitude, but I thought, quote, unquote, I thought it was her word, or whatever, I forget now, is the neutral structure. I thought it is, immediately shifts the point of view to that of the speaker, because then the present tense becomes the present tense of the speaker at that very moment. And
historical,
everywhere. Whenever you have the speaker present in the structure, and this is how the sequential temporum works in Polish, shifts the point of view, and that's why I insisted on using it. Now, which I don't claim it's the only right thing to do. But my strategy is fairly consistent. It was to show the historian behind the history text, because this is the rationale of British historiography as represented by Gibbon, Taylor, Davis. So this was my idea of being faithful, and at the back of my mind was the desire to get some readers, right, of the Polish version. Right? Now, as to the slang, You do indeed speak like my editor, and that's not a bad thing to do at all, because it's an additional challenge. But what you say has a more general theoretical significance, meaning, do we need a translation series in the sense of Edvard Bartzesian's idea that every text that deserves it should be retranslated after, let's say, a generation has passed, because it ages. And but I still believe that if Spanersky skyscraper is read, say, 20 years from now, the reaction would be, so this is what Davis, the then 70-year-old Polish historian, thought about it. Okay? Okay? And to use outdated slang would be ridiculous. And to use the slang as it will be in 20 years' time would be impossible. So I just did what I could, I suppose.
Okay, thank you. We still have 6 minutes for discussion. Professor Lewis?
And I wonder whether the same argument could be made about Davies' own writing, that for whatever reason he's chosen to use very colloquial language at certain points, which no doubt will sound silly in 20 years, but that's a risk he's willing to take in order to have an effect now. I wanted to ask you, Professor Tarakowska, you cite, I can't remember who you cite, to say that historical truth is the poetic imagination of the historian. And a lot of your argument is that history is a kind of writing. I'm struck by the parallel with the argument within anthropology, starting in the mid-1980s, that ethnography is a kind of fiction, because the ethnographer is creating it. But it always seemed to me that that was very problematic, because fiction, in the English-speaking, well, in the Western English-speaking world, is a specific genre. And it's an enormous and powerful genre. It's a genre you find in drugstores and in train stations. And everyone reads it, and fiction sells. And to assimilate ethnography to fiction, it seemed to me was a kind of imperialism. Because ethnography has its own purposes, which are very different from the purposes of fiction. You're trying to portray a lived situation and your experience and other people's experiences in a way that's very different from a novel, it seemed to me, and that there was room for a defense of ethnography specifically, you know, as something different from fiction. So my question for you is, how is history different from fiction and from other uses of the author's imagination?
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking, because I'm afraid to say what I'd like to say. I would say there's no difference. And I know it's not a very safe thing to say. But in fact, both of them have what the literary scholars call the represented world, świat przedstawiony, right? And the problem only involves what is the distance between the represented world and what we would like to think is the real world. Because what anthropology says is also a single or collective view of what a group of scholars at a given time, in a given place, believe things are like. And that's exactly what the fiction writer does. And you would say that the purpose of literature is to make us see certain human values. Doesn't anthropology aim at that too? It is to fascinate. Both of them do that. I don't think there is a difference in it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you very much. I think we should discuss it over coffee, right?
I have a question for my colleague. I wonder if you could speak to why in English language logos tend to be associated with word in such a narrow sense.
Thank you for the question. Yes, I think it tells the question how it meant gender, how the Greek culture entered the Western world, right? We accepted that it's word, and I think it might be connected with this old mistranslations, right? Still just dealing with translation into Bulgarian, into Latin. No, I think that it was St. Jerome who translated logos as word, and that's how it went, instead of translating it just thinking that, you know, still just the first meaning, the very first sense, actually not meaning, but the first sense of it is calculating, computing, counting, and reasoning. Right, so just he might have deduced it to the weight of reason, so but at the same time, it was just saying Apostle John who wrote about this, so maybe he was just too afraid to think about this higher mind, higher reason, or high intelligence, and that's why he was okay, this is a good symbol, right? Dealing with word, what we neglect, there is one point that we have absolutely different understanding of word. For us, word is something written. It's absolutely different from the time when New Testament was written, because at that time, the word was spoken. So now we know word is something in between gaps. What was word when you hear it, and when our ancient ancestors heard. Did they hear gaps? Did they hear pauses? Did they hear intonations? Or vice versa? They had syllables. Maybe word is something between syllables. Or maybe there were just something between two most important syllables in the sentence. So this is a question which still is to ponder over and to think just that. But we definitely say that this writing culture changed us a lot, right? And that's what theology returned us, that we have to think about this, that